coming to you from his downtown Denver studio. Here is the Backstage Jazz Show with your host, Steve Roby.
Hello, and welcome to a very special edition of the Backstage Jazz Show. Today, we'll honor jazz giant Eddie Henderson. In this episode, we'll hear from Andrew Palomara, the gallery coordinator for the exhibit Time and Spaces, Michelle Carpenter, a documentarian for the film Dr. Eddie Henderson, Uncommon Genius. But up first is Mark Rabidow, a tenured professor of music at Colorado University and a good friend to Eddie Henderson. Be sure to stick around for my interview with Dr. Henderson toward the end of this podcast.
When I first met Eddie, I hosted a radio show on the Upper West Side of New York City at a club called Smoke. And Smoke is indelible with Eddie Henderson. He had been performing there many, many years. And week after week, I'd have a chance to meet some incredible artists. But I knew Dr. Eddie Henderson was coming. And I thought, boy, this is intimidating. This is somebody who's really lived an astonishing life. And we went that evening. Eddie, of course, sounded magnificent and told his story in an interview. And I just thought it was so impressive. The next morning, I came home. And my son, Luke, who's now 24 years old, but was in second grade at the time, and he said, hey, Dad, I'm doing a book report for second grade for Black History Month, and I'm thinking about doing Harriet Tubman. And I said, well, Harriet Tubman's a great choice, Luke, but my guess is somebody else might be covering that Harriet Tubman angle. Let me tell you about the great Dr. Eddie Henderson. He grew up in the middle of the Harlem Renaissance. His mom danced for Duke Ellington's Cotton Club, and his dad sang in the Charioteers, who sang on the Bing Crosby show 5 nights a week. In and out of the house was the great Lena Horne and Billie Holiday, Duke Ellington himself. So this person grew up in this amazing culture of creativity and intellect and inspiration. Eddie took his first trumpet lesson with the great Louis Armstrong and went on and studied with Miles Davis. He came then to Denver to serve our nation in the Air Force here at Lowry Air Force Base, and then trained alongside the Olympic team that infamously went down into the Atlantic Ocean about 62 years ago. But Eddie wasn't on that plane. It's because at that time, you could not be a professional Black figure skater. Eddie broke those barriers down and became our nation's first African-American professional figure skater, training here on DU's campus and also in Colorado Springs. That's right. Then he went back to school and earned a medical doctorate at Howard University and became a practicing physician in San Francisco, where he began studying with Miles Davis and at night performing until Herbie Hancock called him and said, Eddie, it's time to come out on the road and make your career there. And you've been on the road for 60 years playing all over the world with the world's greatest jazz artists. And has truly became one of the greatest jazz figures ever. So I told Luke the story, and he said, well, Dad, do you think I could interview Dr. Henderson? I said, oh, man, this is somebody I just met, and I'm a little nervous about it. I said, we could script this thing within an inch of its life. So Luke got his script together, and Eddie agreed to take the interview. Luke did a beautiful job, second grader interview, and he popped one last question at the end. He said, Dr. Henderson, I'll be reading my book report on Tuesday morning at Irving Elementary School. Would you like to come and play your trumpet? And I thought, So I got on the phone ready to apologize. He said, Mark, I've got a gig at Irving Elementary School. I'll need some directions. And Eddie came out when he got back to New York and came and played alongside, you know, my little second grader's book report. Eddie still has that book report hanging in his living room today after all these years. And so what an amazing story. And then a few years later, Eddie had asked me if I would be willing to write his biography. And I was always hesitant to do so, because as a white male, I did not want to try to tell the complex story of this remarkable gentleman's journey, the incredible and also the very difficult that we understand many Americans face. And so as the years went by and he would once in a while circle back to this, I thought, Eddie, I think I have a different answer for you now. I've met this incredible colleague who tells stories so authentically and so beautifully and with such integrity. And I wonder if you would be willing to meet my friend Michelle Carpenter and talk about the idea of making a documentary on your life. And indeed, Michelle has been able to accomplish that just this year. So thank you, Michelle.
Next, we'll hear from Michelle Carpenter, the filmmaker for Dr. Eddie Henderson, Uncommon Genius.
Mark came to me and said, hey, I got this really cool person. There's a wonderful story. Would you want to tell it? And I said, yeah, let's go for it. So I met Eddie and we were able to get some funding and we flew out and filmed him in New York City. So the first thing I do when I'm starting to make a documentary film is I do a lot of research and I start going out onto the internet and exploring what's out there. There were some really good biographies on Eddie, so I looked at those. And then I think about what do I not know about Eddie Henderson that I'd like to know about Eddie Henderson. So I start making a long list of questions that I think I would want to ask. And typically as a documentary filmmaker, you want to start with your kind of least important questions first, because you want your talent to warm up and be comfortable with you. Well, with people like Eddie, he's used to being on stage, so that's not a problem warming up, right? He's comfortable immediately. But yeah, I think about what would I want to know about Eddie that was interesting? And his life is so amazing. You know, Olympic class figure skater, medical doctor, psychiatrist, world-renowned jazz musician. What more could you ask? When I go into documentary filmmaking, I try to approach it from a really creative standpoint. And I teach motion graphics at the University of Colorado Denver. So I'm teaching my students how to make these kind of really compelling graphic assets. And so I always want my visuals to be, you know, just not a photo zooming in and zooming out. I want them to be really have motion and color. I worked with an alum, Josh Blair, who is my motion artist, and he designed all of my motion assets that go in there. I made a few of them because we needed more. Mm-hmm. But he created that. What we do is we get together and we look at Eddie and we think about Eddie. And I thought of him, his mid-century modern was my vibe I got off of him. And I kind of wanted to go into kind of an urban orangish palette. And Josh agreed with me and he ran with it. So then he comes up with designs that we call style frames. And we agreed upon them, typography choices, and we went forward with the design. But yeah, I like to use, instead of using static images, really create some kind of interesting animated asset, because that's what I teach. Eddie, you know, his story is so strong, and he really didn't go into a lot of the obstacle that he faced being a Black musician in the 50s, 40s, 50s, and 60s. But I think what you can really tell that not being able to compete at a high level in figure skating because he was Black was a huge barrier and it was a really huge hit on his heart. You could tell that was really emotional and powerful for him. I think one of the things that I wanted to get to was kind of the more colorful aspects in his history, maybe hanging with the boys on the road and those things. But Eddie wouldn't go there with me, and neither would his bandmates. And I think I love the fact that Mike Clark says in there, "I'd love to tell you, but I can't." I hope that this film might introduce it to a younger audience that might not know and might not appreciate it. I think, you know, the goal of the documentary is to bring you in, capture you in the story, and keep you engaged for a full 30 minutes. And I think we do a pretty good job at that. And I think a younger demographic is always important in bringing you into the story. What I think is cool about the exhibit, Time and Spaces, right here in the Denver Performing Arts Complex, is that there's a new video that I call Time and Spaces that are excerpts that didn't make it into the film. So that's what made it onto the cutting floor. It didn't fit into the path of the story. But what I love about these little clips that are here in the gallery is it's about discipline, his discipline in being an artist, a medical student, a doctor, figure skater. And then there's also things about all the famous people he met in the, you know, boxers like Joe Louis and Sugar Ray and Cameron Hank. And then Willie Mays lived at his house in the 50s. So that's pretty exciting. And then he also met Jesse Owens. He tried to race Jesse Owens as a small child. He thought he could beat him, right? And it's such a great clip. And then at the end, he talks about going into a job that you love. And it's about the love of the art form and really loving what you do. Mm. And he loves music and he loves jazz. And that's contagious. And I think it's a great message for all people. You should love what you do for your job. The film is going to different film festivals around the country. And it's really interesting. People, too, that own jazz clubs are reaching out to me to show the film. And I just talked to a gentleman in Maine that wants to bring the film and Eddie Henderson up to play, you know, a set along with the film and kind of frame it in this way. So I'm thinking about trying to market it in different ways, but it will have a film festival life and it will have a TV life. And then hopefully it has 3 years on broadcast.
Andrew Palomara is the gallery coordinator for Time and Spaces, The Life of Eddie Henderson, which premiered at the CU Denver Experience Gallery in the Denver Performing Arts Complex. Here he explains the details of putting an exhibit like this together.
We took a huge lead from a documentary film about Eddie Henderson called Uncommon Genius, which was made by one of our faculty at CU Denver, Michelle Carpenter. We met with her and Mark Rabideau, who's our associate dean and also produced the film, to talk about ways that we could further illustrate some of the themes and the concepts in the film. Fortunately, we got to use some parts of the film in the show as well. So there's video, we have photos, we've got record covers, all these different aspects of his life, and we really wanted it to be about his life well lived. He's done a lot of different things, and we wanted to capture that in a way that didn't feel overly exceptional, but also didn't underplay just how multifaceted this guy is. Like I said, we took a lot of cues from the film in terms of tone, what to emphasize and what not to emphasize as much. And in some ways, the film made it easy. In other ways, we had to take some liberties in illustrating some of these things. We've got a couple of artworks that are from other people that are not directly involved with Eddie, have collaborated directly with Eddie, but have made works in response to Eddie's music. So that feels like an extension of his legacy of making art for people. Our gallery space is pretty open, not a ton of walls in the middle of the space. So when you walk in, what you get. So we knew that it would be a little tricky to try to tell a linear story. And instead, we wanted to try to demonstrate different aspects of that life and try to integrate them as much as we can. Because one of the things that we picked up on once we met Eddie and talked with him, and then once we saw the film, was how integrated those things are in his own life. They seem really segmented on paper, but they're just a part of who he is. And especially when you consider that he was starting his figure skating career while he was starting out as a jazz musician. He didn't do one and then do the next. He was doing all these things at the same time. We thought we might as well just take that approach with the exhibition as well. And instead of creating specific sections, just merging those things all together. You'll see, you know, on one wall, we've got some photos from Eddie that have featured in the film, but we have printed some copies and we've got him in his Air Force uniform, him figure skating, him with Herbie Hancock and the band, all mixed together. That was our general approach was, let's just try to mix these things together in an intuitive way. We only have so much space in the gallery and there's only so many stories that we can tell. So the challenge is then, how do you plant the seed of the story so that other people will want to learn more about him once they leave the gallery? And that's certainly our hope, is when they come through, they discover someone that they probably don't know. I think for people who love jazz, Eddie Henderson's a household name, maybe not as much for people that are on the outskirts of jazz. I think we felt a responsibility to lay the groundwork for who he is and hope that people will come away thinking, I want to go listen to his records. I want to go catch him live, whatever. Spatially, we had some challenges. Because this was centered around someone who does not create visual art, the other challenge was, how do we illustrate this person's story without visual art? Because that's what we specialize in. We had objects from Eddie's life. We have the film. We've got, as I mentioned, these artworks that were inspired by Eddie's music. Trying to find a nice combination of all of those things, and it still feels like it mixes together well. We're really fortunate that we got to talk to Eddie a couple months ago before we started installing the show. And we were pretty keen to take cues from him on how to illustrate that part of his story. And he mentions it when you talk to him, he mentions it in the film, but it didn't feel like the thing that he kept coming back to. I think he was more animated by the people that he met along the way, the things that he got to do, having a real sense of gratitude for the life that he's had. I think in a basic level, by putting his story front and center, we feel that we're doing our part in overcoming those racial barriers. We're not treating it with kid gloves. There's no asterisk behind it. It's just, here's a magnificent guy who's done a lot of great things. And then once you dig deeper into the exhibition, you'll see how he overcame racial barriers and figure skating especially, but in other facets of his life. Trying not to overstate it, but also not understate it either. And I hope that we found some middle ground there. We were fortunate to have access to a lot of photos that came from Eddie that were in the film. And so we've got one with him performing with Art Blakey, one with him next to Duke Ellington, and then obviously him with the Herbie Hancock band. So that reflects his musical connections. The film dives more into his relationship with Louis Armstrong and Miles Davis. So we let the film speak for those things. And then we've also got record covers, two from his solo records and then one from his work with Herbie Hancock. The trouble is that we can't contain all of these collaborations all in one exhibition. So we tried to pick and choose the ones that we thought were most representative, but then we hope that people will come away from this wanting to dig deeper into Eddie, and then they'll find the collaborations with Pharoah Sanders and Lee Morgan and all these other guys. It was a real challenge for sure to try to fit all of that in and then strike the balance between people who may know a little bit about jazz, know nothing, people know a lot. So we're trying to shoot for the middle there.
If you're enjoying the Backstage Jazz Show, we'd love for you to like, subscribe, and leave a review on Apple Podcasts. And now, back to the show.
This is Steve Roby, and I'm interviewing jazz trumpeter Eddie Henderson today. Eddie, thank you for doing this interview.
My pleasure.
Can you share some memorable moments or experiences working with artists like Herbie Hancock, Art Blakey, or others?
Absolutely. Number one is Herbie Hancock. That was my first gig of any stature where I played with musicians on such a high level. And I was just in awe of playing with those guys. It was just a wonderful experience and something that really opened the door for me to continue my career up to the present time. I'm really indebted to that experience in my life. And in terms of my stint with Art Blakey, that happened right after Herbie Hancock's band ended. And then Art Blakey called me. And because I played with Herbie Hancock, all my other heroes, people like McCoy Tyner, Joe Henderson, Art Blakey, Elvin Jones, Maxwell, they all hired me by virtue of the fact that I played with her. So that was a significant springboard to play with other people. And in terms of experience with Art Blakey, that was an invaluable experience. Art Blakey and the Jazz Messengers, because it was like the postgraduate school of initiation for young musicians to come and learn the craft. Because he literally taught you how to play melodies. And he says, make the notes become alive, a living presence, you know. It's not just a note, it's a real thing. So when you make the melody become alive, after that, everything takes place. And then he actually taught you how to build. He says, tell a story. It's like you open a book, the beginning, you're in the middle of the book, you reach the climax, and then the end. That's how he looked at a solo. And he says, and when you're finished with the show, get out of there. Then next guy coming up.
Yeah.
You know.
Cool. Is there a specific project or album that holds a special place in your heart?
Yes. For me, it was my first album that I ever did with Herbie Hancock. The first time I ever recorded the M1 Dishi album.
In San Francisco, right?
It was in San Francisco, Wally Irish Studio.
Yeah.
I never, every time somebody mentions that, I could almost see it right in front of my face. That was just like a spiritual experience, just looking around, realizing, oh, I'm playing with these guys. And the music was just divine.
Wow. Super.
Yeah. And it really changed my whole life. Because up to that point, I was just playing local gigs around San Francisco. And I thought that was what I was going to do for the rest of my life. Yeah. And it just elevated me to a point. It was undeniable. No doubt in my mind what I wanted to do for the rest of my life. I got that gig just by a fluke accident. Johnny Coles, the original trumpet player before me with Herbie Hancock, he was on a sabbatical with Ray Charles for six months.
Okay.
So Herbie needed a trumpet player for 1 week. So after that 1 week was over, you know, I was just ecstatic. And they were going to go back to New York. And I was heartbroken. I told Billy Hart, I said, you know, I would really like to just stay in this band. He said, well, go propose to Herbie. So I went to Herbie. I said, well, you know, I would really like to be in the band. He said, but you're a doctor. I said, the hell with that. I will always be a doctor. I have my license.
Right.
So he thought for about 2 to 3 seconds. He just said, you're in the band.
Nice.
Just like that.
Nice.
And that changed the whole trajectory for the rest of my life.
Wow. As a trumpeter, are there any specific techniques or approaches you've developed that define your playing style?
Oh, well, in terms of playing jazz, yes. Because when my first exposure to jazz that really touched my musical being was listening to Miles Davis. I tried to emulate him or play just like him with the records. And Miles told me, you know, his style, concept, sound, and everything.
Yeah.
He said, you know, why don't I stop trying to imitate him? I said, wow. Because my parents let me, when Miles was staying at my parents' house for 2 weeks, my parents had me play for him with the records. I played with the record.
Okay. Yeah.
So Miles, Sketches of Spain. So Miles told me, he said, you sound good, but that's me. I said, well, Jesus Christ. So the next time he came back to town and stayed at my parents' house, he walks in. But in that interim, a year later, I found out that the guy he copied and his hero was a guy named Freddie Webster, who nobody, not that many people know, because he only recorded 8 bars of solo on a Dinah Washington album. That was Miles's hero, who he copied and emulated. So when Miles came back a year later, knocked on the door, I answered the door. He said, are you still trying to sound like me? I said, you mean Freddie Webster? The look on Miles' face, his jaw dropped to the floor. He smiled and chuckled and whispered in my ear, everybody's a thief. I just made a short-term loan. In terms of my style, it's just a reflection of me. So I asked him, I said, well, how do you play? I said, what do you think about it? So he said, learn as many licks as you can and then scotch tape them together. So when people ask me about my style, they said, well, I like your style, Eddie. I said, my style? It's just licks I've scotch taped together or stolen from people that came before me. That's what my style is. Yeah. And that's what Miles Davis's style, he didn't just drop out of the sky abstractly. He scotch taped his heroes that came before him.
That improvised on top of that.
Bingo.
Are there any lessons or wisdom from your mentors that you pass on to the next next generation of musicians?
Yes. I said, always study. You know, you cannot know where you are in the present tense unless you know where the music came from. Mm-hmm. Always go back and look back in the past to your predecessors and see how the music evolved to the present tense, and then learn the basic building blocks of harmony and stuff and chord changes, and then listen to record people's different styles, and then try to formulate your own style. And then, because you cannot go to the future until you know what came in the past. A lot of guys who don't do that, they say, oh, I'm playing some new stuff. I said, man, they played that 50 years ago, but you're not even aware of it.
Wow.
You know?
Yeah. Looking back on your accomplished career, what achievements are you most proud of and why?
What achievements am I most proud of? Well, just the fact that I've gotten an opportunity to play with all of my heroes, and what an honor it is to have been able to play with them. And from each one of those different building blocks of heroes that I've had the opportunity to play with was a learning experience for me. It's a kind of, you know, people say, oh, well, you've really made it. Now, right now, I feel like I'm just a beginner. You know, you never really make it. You always want to polish the mirror of truth, because it will get dusty if you don't polish it.
Yeah, exactly. Everyone has a guilty pleasure in music. Is there a particular song or genre that might surprise your fans to know that you enjoy?
You know, looking back on my career in terms of recording career, when I first started with the M1DC group, playing kind of open skies improvisation. After that, I worked with Art Blakey. I was trying to do that particular area of post-bebop. And then about 1975 is when I started doing the electric stuff, where I did like the Sunburst album. Yeah. And that put me on the map to reach another audience. And also, it's learn another vocabulary. And a lot of the staunch bebop people say, oh, you're not playing jazz, you're playing fusion, you know. And lo and behold, you know, because I don't want to be stuck in any particular genre.
Sure.
You know, because the music keeps evolving as time and events move on.
Right.
But the more idioms I feel that one learns, with fusion, bebop, avant-garde, or just playing standards, that's all different vocabularies.
Yeah.
The more vocabulary you learn, the more eloquently you can speak.
Exactly.
Like it in any language.
Yeah.
And language is so important. You go around the world, you go to different countries, you're at a disadvantage if you can't speak that language.
Right.
You know, but the thing about music, if you learn the basic building blocks of it, I can go to China, I can go to Russia, I can go to South America. I might not be able to speak their language, but I can play with the musicians, because with But music is a universal language.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So you learn the basic building blocks of that language. You can speak anywhere in the world.
What are you currently working on? And are there any upcoming projects or collaborations you're excited about?
Well, I'm really excited the fact that I've been teaching at Oberlin Conservatory of Music in Ohio. And I'm excited because the upcoming generation of musicians is very healthy. And it's so important to pass on the information and experience that I have to the younger generation so I can pass the baton so the music could continue and evolve. Yeah. So I'm really excited about that. And in terms of upcoming projects that I have nothing pre-planned, so to speak. They just happen organically.
Yeah, nice.
One step at a time.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
How would you like to be remembered in the context of jazz history? And what contributions do you hope to leave behind?
In terms of how would I like to be remembered, just as a link in the chain and the evolution. Louis Armstrong was my first teacher. But when I was 9 years old in person, then I met Miles Davis. So that lineage, then there's Dizzy Gillespie, Clifford Brown, Freddie Hubbard, Lee Morgan. Mm-hmm. All those, all of them rubbed off of me. And I'm just a link in the chain, passing the baton to the next generation. Just the legacy of my recordings and from the interviews, the knowledge that I pass on in terms of my philosophy of music.
I saw your speech and performance at the gallery yesterday. What was your reaction when you saw the exhibition tribute at the gallery yesterday?
Well, I think since you saw it, you saw me trying to put tears down my eyes. You know, that was totally unexpected. Yeah. I remember when I got up there getting ready to play, I looked around and realized the fairy tale was actually coming true at that moment. And this overwhelming feeling of gratitude, it just poured out through my eyes and it was overwhelming. And I thought to myself, in front of all these people, I'm going to start crying. But I couldn't stop, the tidal wave. It was just real coming from my true soul, how I felt about it. And I think it was self-explanatory, my feeling, and how I felt all the love coming towards me. I was just overwhelmed with gratitude.
Well, that happened again last night after the first set and your standing ovation. There was a line, I couldn't hear it quite clearly from where I was in the audience, but you said something to the effect of like, I wish I could bottle this moment.
Oh, yes, yes. I said I was so overwhelmed with the wave of appreciation I saw coming from the audience. And I said, I wish I could put this in a bottle and carry around with me for the rest of my life.
That was beautiful. That was simply beautiful. Dr. Henderson, thank you so much for your time today. I really appreciate it.
Oh, my pleasure, my friend.
The Backstage Jazz Show was recorded at Little Raven Studios in downtown Denver, and our producer was Craig Stevens. You can find Backstage Jazz wherever you listen to podcasts. Be sure to stop by our website, backstage-jazz.com, where all past and current episodes have been archived. If you'd like to be a guest on the show, you can email us at backstagejazz@fastmail.com. This is Steve Roby. Thanks for listening, and we'll see you next time on Backstage Jazz.
You've been listening to the Backstage Jazz Show. Join us next time for more great jazz and interviews with your favorite musicians.